One of the most important people in animation history is one who may not be as well known as his early creative partner, but we nonetheless have him to thank for many innovations in the field. And he is none other than Ub Iwerks, whose visual style would not only play a role in the Disney Studios' early successes, but he would influence many other animators over the years. It did not take long for Ub Iwerks to experiment. When Walt Disney's early Laugh-O-Gram cartoons almost made him bankrupt, they decided to try something more innovative and attention-grabbing. The Alice comedies combine live-action with animation by depicting a young girl entering a cartoon world. Started in 1923, these early shorts provide a glimpse at what would later become the hallmarks that make Disney so wildly successful. Technical innovation combined with endearing characters. While the likes of Winsome McKay and the Fleischer Brothers had also mixed the two mediums together, Iwerks took the hybrid approach to the next level with the Alice comedies. Following the end of that series, Disney and Iwerks created a new character named Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. The intent with this cute little rabbit was to create a cartoon personality that was uniquely his own, thus allowing him to stand out from the pack. The inventive gags they came up with helped fuel Oswald's personality, with Iwerks' animation giving him the needed bounciness and charm, although he also had his occasional mischievous side. In 1928, producer Charles Mintz and Universal Pictures took control of Oswald away from Walt Disney, along with most of his animators. One of the few who stuck by Walt's side was Ub Iwerks, and together they tried to come up with a new cartoon star that nobody else could take away. Various animals were tested out. One was a cow, who would later become Clarabelle Cow, and another was a horse, who was eventually named Horace Horsecollar. Iwerks even suggested a frog at one point. Eventually, he drew a mouse who looked sort of like Oswald, except he had round ears and a thin tail. And with that, Mickey Mouse was born. They then tried to figure out how to get the audience attached to this mouse. They produced a few silent cartoons, but they eventually hit upon the idea of using the new technology of synchronized sound. The first Mickey Mouse sound cartoon, Steamboat Willie, was an enormous success upon its debut on November 18, 1928. Iwerks served as the principal animator for Steamboat Willie, and several of the first shorts produced by Walt Disney as an independent filmmaker. His animation skills allowed the characters to move in unique ways, and elevated gags that were already funny in the initial drawings. This early version of Mickey was quite the troublemaker at times, and Iwerks deserves so much credit for injecting him with the needed burst of energy and enthusiasm. The wild spirit of those cartoons can also be partly attributed to Iwerks and the ways he moved the characters on the screen. The use of music and sound effects would especially become an important element of the cartoons, which Iwerks took full advantage of. When searching for a composer for the shorts, Disney met Carl Stalling, who hit upon the idea of a series where music would play a pivotal role in how the animation was presented. Thus, the Silly Symphonies were born, with Skeleton Dance being the first. This is pure Ub Iwerks, with him finding all sorts of creative uses for the skeletons. There's also a dimensionality to the skeletons that adds to the wonderfully macabre imagery. Despite his role in the success of the Disney cartoons, Iwerks was not quite as well known to the general public, with Walt often getting most of the recognition for creating Mickey Mouse. In 1930, Iwerks decided he wanted to produce his own cartoons and left the Disney Studios to create his own place, signing a deal with Pat Powers and a distribution agreement with MGM. Remember that frog I mentioned? Well, he would become the first cartoon star of Iwerks' new studio, named Flip the Frog. The first Flip cartoon, Fiddlesticks, established him as a dancing frog among other woodland critters, including one who looks strangely familiar. Eventually, he would leave the forest and instead become a city frog, who would take part in a variety of odd jobs. Iwerks' penchant for energetic cartoon gags continued in the Flip the Frog cartoons, and he was able to find a number of amusing scenarios for the character. Carl Stalling also followed Iwerks to his new studio, and his music would also help these cartoons become memorable among animation enthusiasts. Unfortunately, Flip the Frog did not take off with audiences, especially as other cartoon stars like Mickey and the Fleischer's Betty Boop rose in popularity. In 1933, Iwerks tried his hand at another series with Willy Whopper, a mischievous child with an overactive imagination. Willy went through a few designs, but just lacked an interesting enough personality for audiences to latch onto. Even for cartoon historians, he's more of a curiosity than anything else, and there are other aspects of his shorts that have not aged all that well. Iwerks then created the Comic Color cartoons, which adapted classic stories with unique spins. With these shorts, Iwerks and his team of animators, including the legendary Grim Natwick, found creative ways to utilize these well-known literary and fairy tale figures. Stories like The Legend of Sleepy Hollow, Puss in Boots, Don Quixote, and Aladdin were given a touch only found in these adaptations, with a particular emphasis on comedy. Iwerks also put together his own multi-plane camera that was taken advantage of in these color shorts. These shorts have been largely overshadowed by other animated adaptations, but they are still worth a watch. Iwerks also found himself working with other animation studios on their cartoon series. He directed two Looney Tunes cartoons for Leon Schlesinger Productions, most notably 1937's Porky and Gabby. This short paired up Porky Pig with the short-lived character Gabby the Goat as they attempt to go on a camping trip. Iwerks' high energy is evident in this cartoon, with the results being appropriately humorous. Iwerks directed a number of Color Rhapsody cartoons for Screen Gems, which allowed him to further flex his muscles on some fantastical animation. Meanwhile, Skeleton Frolics had him returning to familiar territory, as it depicted a musical band of skeletons. It is quite remarkable comparing that short with Skeleton Dance, and seeing the evolution of animation. In 1940, Ub Iwerks closed up shop at his namesake studio and returned to Disney, which at that point had expanded to produce feature films. Iwerks took on a different role working in the visual effects department, where he developed technology that would help animated characters seamlessly interact with actors in a live-action environment. This proved especially important in The Three Caballeros, which had Donald Duck interact with people like Carmen Miranda's sister, Aurora. Song of the South was another pivotal accomplishment from Iwerks due to the sequences of Br'er Rabbit appearing on screen with the human actors. Iwerks did not just work on the hybrid films at Disney. His knowledge of the multiplane camera's functions would help give a dimension to the likes of Cinderella and Peter Pan, resulting in many of those films' most iconic and enchanting moments. Iwerks was an important figure in Disney becoming a major player in live-action films and documentaries. The technology he developed aided in giving Disney movies that extra magic. His special processes were used to great effect in the Disney True Life Adventure in Nature documentaries. He made audiences believe that the Nautilus was really underwater in 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, that there were two Haley Mills in the Parent Trap, and that Mary Poppins could fly in from the sky. Iwerks also developed the Xerox process that enabled the 101 Dalmatians to have their many spots. He even had a hand in the theme parks, working on the animatronics for classic attractions like It's a Small World and the Hall of Presidents. Iwerks did not just work with Disney in his later years, though. When Alfred Hitchcock needed to have a flock of birds attack a group of schoolchildren, he called up Ub Iwerks. Iwerks' effects for the birds were revolutionary and earned the desired terrified reaction from audiences. He even earned a well-deserved Academy Award nomination for the special effects in The Birds. And while he did not win that Oscar, the Academy did give him a Technical Achievement Award for designing an improved optical printer for special effects and matte shots, and an Academy Award of Merit for the conception and perfection of techniques for color-traveling matte composite cinematography. And many years later, the organization, Asifa Hollywood, which produces the Annie Awards, created the Ub Iwerks Award, which honors those whose technical innovation helped animation evolve and move forward. Animation certainly would not have been the same without the incredible creativity and technological know-how of Ub Iwerks. Thank you for everything you've done for the art form. See you next time.